After all these difficult cases from Mr. Katsyouvas, I would suggest to make a cheerful break with some more lighter refractive cases. But first of all, we have to become masters of the refractive way of thinking so we can decide what to do to our patients. So what are our treatment options? First, the excimer laser combined with monovision or not. Then is the Presby laser combined with monovision or not. What is Presby laser? Is a laser treatment where we induce negative spherical aberrations due to make some more depth of focus to our patient. The third, we can use a monofocal IOLs, again with some monovision or not. We can choose some phakic IOLs, or we choose between multifocal IOLs and induced depth of focus IOLs. What is this? The EDOFs are like multifocals, but they produce plus 1.5 diopters for nearsightedness, and they do not have so many rings on the surface, so they don't produce so many aberrations. And the next, the last one, is the phototherapeutic keratectomy for some cases. So when we are going to do some myopic laser treatment, our considerations are always the K1 and K2 readings. Every diopter we have to correct is one diopter of K readings going down. We should aim for emetropia if we don't have a perfect visual system, like amblyopia or some macula problem. Always think of the residual stroma, must be over 300. And we have also keep tissue for some regression and enhancement. Almost the same is for hyperopic treatments, but consider that always LASIK is more preferable because we have more amount of regression and we have to make more often enhancements. The residual stroma is not a problem because the laser profile is more in the periphery where is always enough tissue. If we have to put a phakic IOL, we have to consider always the depth of the anterior chamber to have enough space and the number of the cells from the endothelium. About the intraocular lenses, we have to make a perfect capsulorhexis. 5 millimeters is the ideal length. We must align the lens perfect, so we have to, after we put the lens, to wait and see through the microscope if it's good aligned. And of course, we have to have always good information about the fundus. So the first case is a 20-year-old patient. He had some myopic astigmatism, and he wants to have a laser operation. We did the topography, and you can see here is 51, the steepness. So the question is, he's young, what are you going to do? We can vote, you can vote here. Yes, sometimes it's wise not to do anything, okay? Send them home, say, I'm sorry about it.
To the neighbor.
Huh?
Send it to the neighbor.
To the neighbor. Yeah. Okay, have you voted? So 58 is laser plus cross-linking, okay? What do we miss here? What happened? Nobody asked about the other eye, okay? And I'm telling you the other eye is totally perfect. It's totally normal eye. So never make a decision before having information about the back surface of the cornea. And this is his back surface, and there is no elevation at all. Okay, what happened here? We sent the patient home, and he came back 3 weeks later. This is his deepness. Ugh. It was 51, now it's 48. Okay? And we sent him again home. He came after 1 month. It's better. And after 2 months' time, this is his surface, okay? It was a contactless overwear syndrome.
Can you go back to surface?
Which one?
Yes. How to read the map? Because sometimes we read the colors and not the numbers. You have your map. You have the analyzing system for the pentagram with relative 0.25. Okay. Go back. Go to the next one. You switch to 0.50. This thing changes the whole thing with the color. You should be consistent with what you use. You should always use the same scheme about measuring, about following your eyes. So if you switch from 0.25 to 0.50, it changes the colors, but doesn't change the numbers.
It will always be 48, okay?
It will always be 48.
Just look at the numbers and not at the colors.
Go to the next one. You go back to 0.25.
Yes, but it will be always 45, okay?
But now the numbers change.
Yes. You're right. Okay, let's carry on. So we did the laser treatment, and this is what happened. Okay, this is a vertical gas breakthrough. What is this? This is when the bubbles, they don't stay in the interface, and they find a way out subepithelial, okay? The most common reason is a scar on the cornea, maybe from a bacterial infection or from a foreign body. Okay, so what should we do here? Please vote. Ready?
So it's up to you to decide.
Yes.
The help from the audience was nothing really.
Well, try to lift the flap. You leave dangerously, okay? Because you might try to go with a needle and separate it, but in most of the cases, this won't happen. And then you end up with a separated flap. So you don't have the positive things of femtosecond laser, which is if you don't open it, you end up with a perfect cornea again after some hours, okay? So it's not advisable to try to lift the flap. The most conservative, safe way is to do some PRK, forget about flaps, and go for PRK after the refraction is stabilized. This is now a picture 3 days after a LASIK surgery. Can anybody make a suggestion? What is this? This is whitish granulomatous precipitates. Anybody? There are some refractive surgeries here. I can see some.
You have never seen that?
Does it remind you Sahara, huh? Emanuelidis.
Diffuse lamellar keratitis, okay?
You must have seen so many Emanuelidis.
Okay, just tell it. A long ago. Okay. This is more rare, but more aggressive. Anybody? It's more centrally and not very diffuse.
Central toxic keratitis, ventral keratitis.
Exactly, Dimitri.
It's a subtype of DLK.
This is not 2 or 3 days after the surgery. This is 10 days after the surgery. What is this? It was perfect. The patient was very happy, and then he calls us and says, something is wrong. I can't say why, what, but something is wrong. What is this?
Go Anybody? To basics. Go to basics.
Please come, be more interactive, please. Yeah. Anyone? Don't be ashamed.
Go to basics. When you see someone, what do? You do the slit
can,
lamp and you check the pressure.
You can see better with retroillumination.
You check the pressure. Always check the pressure.
Okay. This is pressure-induced stromal keratopathy. Okay. And some more days after this, they went to Mr. Gadziufas, this one. What is this? You can see 2 infiltrates here, and conjunctival erythema. Okay, this is bacterial infection. What is the common thing about all these 4 pictures? They all started from the interface, okay? So we have to distinguish them, okay? Many doctors call me back and say, I see some precipitates. Is this the DLK you tell me about, okay, the next day? Or is something else, something on the surface? How can we distinguish this, Dimitri, if it's on the surface or if it's interstromal?
It's very easy.
Yes?
You get the slit lamp examination. From the slit lamp examination.
Just stay in it, okay? You have to stay in it. So, there is a very nice picture here. This is the DLK and central toxic keratopathy. This is the pressure induced, and this is the infection. For DLK and CTK, you don't have to have an alive microorganism. Also, some pieces, some tissues from the microorganism can cause this, okay? And always remember the typical onset. This is the reason why you can never send some LASIK patient home, okay, after the treatment, because you have to see them the next day because of the fear of DLK or CTK, okay? Now, the location between this is difficult. DLK is always diffuse. That's why it's the name diffuse lamellar. But CTK is more focal, well-defined, and maybe it spreads to the anterior and posterior surface from the intrastomal cut. It doesn't stay in one point. Okay. Now, about the haze, after the granular haze in the DLK, it goes to corneal melting. Okay, this is a very dangerous situation. In CTK, it goes always to corneal melting. Now, conjunctival erythema you can have only in infection, okay? And as Milto say, just measure the pressure. But the problem is that if there is enough fluid, with a Goldman instrument, you can measure a normal pressure. So you have to have other instruments, okay, to measure the true pressure.
Or you measure the refraction.
Or the refraction.
Have regression.
Yes. So this is very interesting. You must not put steroids on the central toxic keratopathy. Okay? Maybe it's going to get worse. You have to put some anti-inflammatory drops maybe and some antioxidants from the mouth. It will dissolve anyway in 7 to 8 months after the exposure, okay? And for the DLK, you have always to remember if the first 2 days they don't respond to the cortisone treatment, you have always lift the flap and irrigate. It will always go very well after this. And this is the latest intrastolmar complication. What is this? Everybody knows. What is this? Ingrowth, okay. When do we act? Excuse me. Three things, okay? What is in the visual axis and cause irregular astigmatism and it's caused for corneal melting, okay? So now we became masters of the refractive way of thinking. So the first patient is 47. He has high myopia, lens clear, fundus normal, so it's a refractive case paradise. Anybody, any suggestion? Shall we go on with a nice laser treatment? Maybe leave some 2 or 3 diopters of myopia because our laser treatment cannot go till 12 diopters. Do you agree with this? Miltos, would you do a laser treatment?
Well, I have to see the cornea.
Perfect cornea.
Everything is perfect.
Yes.
For me,
it's paradise.
Case one is clear lens extraction. He starts going to the area of 45, 47, so it's not a big deal to do it. Or to do a PRK, transepithelial PRK. These are the two things in my mind. I know that you say that he's old enough and he may have some healing problems, but really, I've never encountered that many healing problems on 45. So okay. Probably either a PRK to be on the safe side or clear lens extraction to without a multifocal lens, but with an end-of lens to give him some enhanced depth of focus. So you can choose from these two.
Yes. I would consider about his K readings. If they are very low, then you're going to have many aberrations for such a big ablation. Okay.
Can I comment on that also?
Yes, please.
I never go up to, I always go for refraction, for refractive solutions, up to 100 microns of ablation. No more than 100 microns of ablation. I think minus 11 is way more than 100 microns of ablation.
It's going to induce too many.
And why you do that?
It's not about the residual stromal bread that I have to leave, but it's always the analogy of the residual stroma in concern of the total cornea.
Good. Okay. Because so you're bringing
you may,
the issue of PDK.
Yes, yes.
What if about PRK? With PRK, you don't change so much the analogy, so what is the problem to doing PRK?
The risk of having a haze with such a great ablation, it's very high.
Have you seen that?
No.
Okay, good. So there's a high risk, but you haven't seen it.
Yes.
Interesting.
Because I was trained in a center where we did last LASIK, which is PRK. We did PRK for every patient from minus 1 to minus 11. We had a large series of patients with minus 9, minus 10, and we didn't have a single thing of haze, a single case of haze in large scale myopias. I think it's a miracle. I think they have some kind of protection by tissue or by God.
It's not a sunny place where we have been, that's why.
I've seen the worst case of hazes in the moderate scale of myopia from minus 3 to minus 6. And not for the extreme myopia, but even so, I wouldn't dare do a PRK in minus 10.
Okay, this. Carry on.
Yeah, it's also the consideration of the long-term stability of the results. There's a high risk for regressions. You don't want your patient to be happy for 18 months, but long-term. So in this case, I would definitely go for clear lens exchange. Laser would not be an option for me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, maybe Zizi, then the next case. He's 57, okay? He's hyperop, and now he has cataract. Good fundus. What would you suggest? What would you do?
He's a good candidate. He would be a good candidate for...
It's a paradise for again, okay? It's
for him, multifocal lens maybe, yeah?
Yes.
With the exception of amblyopia on the left eye, which might be a problem. You know, the 4 out of 10, it might be a problem, but still I think a good trifocal lens will work perfectly here. I don't think that anybody will go for laser. I don't.
Okay. I think it's a single shot choice. You definitely go for the multifocal IOL. Okay.
Sorry?
As soon as possible.
Clear lens with 10-10. That's the definition of clear lens. It's 10-10 vision, and you try to keep just to do the hyperopic. At which stage? Probably next day. Not the same day, probably next day or 2 days after.
I would do it a few days after, not too long, because these patients will notice a difference and will have issues if you wait too long.
Have you seen patients with one multifocal IOL long term? Because I've seen. Have you had an experience of people, of patients, with only one multifocal IOL and a normal lens?
Yes, they are happy.
They are happy patients.
Yes. Yeah. It was the definition of not doing it. And yet we have seen these patients, and I believe all of you have seen patients with multifocal in one eye, and we have come cases, and they are perfect.
But I'm warning you, don't do this in Germany, because it's strongly forbidden. You cannot implant monofocal lens in one eye and multifocal in the other eye. It's just contraindicated.
You have so many rules in Germany, you know. So.
I mean, sometimes they don't show up for the other eye because they are happy, because the eye that doesn't have so significant cataract, it's a normal eye, and they just don't feel the need to operate the other eye because they are very happy with the one eye.
You have to convince them to come back for the other eye as well.
But I think also that we have a game changer.
They have to pay in advance for both
eyes. The end of lenses. The end of lenses will be introduced more and more, and I think it's a great idea to have them in mind now that they exist. They give you about 1.5 enhanced focus, depth of focus, and if you do a little monovision of half a diopter, then you have a very nice coordination of the two eyes without the problems of the trifocal. So I know that it's something which is early in Greece. We don't use them so many, but I think that Synchrony and the other enhanced depth of focus, do you have experience?
Yes, I think that what you mentioned, micro monovision in aid of a Symphony lens works perfectly well. So this is...
Well, the problem is that we did the procedure. We end up with this result to this patient.
So you did something wrong.
Probably. So.
Okay. So, how do you proceed now, Dimitris? You have.
This is with a multifocal IOL. He has multifocal IOL in both eyes now.
No. Monofocal.
Monofocal.
Yes.
So you didn't do what we said.
No.
Okay.
This is a pseudophakic.
He didn't have money for this.
He's a pseudophakic, and this is the post-op result.
Yes.
Minus 1.5.
Did he pay for that result?
Before the treatment.
And now you have to pay.
I assume that the dominant eye is the right eye. Okay. So I would leave the left eye unchanged to do some monovision, and I will deal only with the right eye.
What to do?
If it's an early intervention, I would do it with the lens extraction, with the lens exchange. If not, you can do a PRK or something else, a refractive surgery, a surface ablation in order to emetropize the right eye.
Okay.
I would implant an add-on lens, a sulcus first Q, or maybe multifocal sulcus for free.
you want you got more problems.
There are piggyback sulcos from Rainer, I think.
It's a sulco flex from Rainer, which is in the first queue from Germany.
I think this is an ideal case for add-on lens, because simply you have done a bad case scenario here, okay? He came for something, you didn't give it, and by exchanging it, you may create more problems.
But if you allow me, this is an excellent candidate, but if you had some astigmatism there, that would not be a good option, because all these lenses have a terrible rotational stability. Just for spherical correction, it's an excellent option.
Even the less exchange with a bigger incision will cause some astigmatism.
I mean, if this patient had a significant amount of astigmatism, the add-on lens would not be a good option, because the available add-on lenses that we have a very poor rotational stability. Yeah. Yeah.
Zachos, right. What did you do here?
PRK.
Good. Solon. There is a certain with these piggyback lenses, you send them to the manufacturer, aiming for, at least in my case, for zero. But the manufacturer will let you decide. It's not a biometry error. Yeah, zero for me.
Zero.
Emmetropia. The ideal is to have at least a 1 week check with a contact lens. Yeah, this is the idea, to have a one-week check with the contact lens and then try it. But anything will be better than this result. But Zachos did the PRK.
He's very happy.
And?
Very happy.
Excellent.
Actually, he was referred for somewhere else.
PRK in the plus two.
Yes.
Hyperoptic
yes.
PRK.
Yes.
And your last case?
It's not the last.
Ah, it's not the last. Okay.
No. Unfortunately.
48
so
years
old. So, what is controversial about this patient? Okay, he's 48 years old. Okay, this is a bit of amblyopia because of the high astigmatism. Okay, but she's a teacher, and she comes and say, "I want." Independence from glasses. What does she mean by that? What she really wants? We have to put some psychologists as well. Okay. She wants to read without glasses. Okay. Can we provide this to her? What do you think, Zissi?
Yes. First of all, be very careful here with teachers.
Teachers are very difficult patients.
They are bad patients for refractive surgery. The teachers. Yes. Add-off lenses are not a good option for these patients, and not everybody trifocal lens is a good option
Why?
For these patients.
Why?
Because the reading performance of among the trifocal lenses is variable. So for this particular patient, I will go for, I have no conflict of interest, any financial interest in any, I would go for a fine vision or a Trilisa, because I have a very good.
A toric one, you mean?
A toric trifocal lens, yes. One of those with good reading performance.
Would you be afraid of the amblyopia, of the poor results of the amblyopia?
I don't think this will have any impact on the quality of vision afterwards.
Anyone else? Okay.
She has to know that she will get what... she has. I mean, you will
discuss
not
everything.
Oversell what. Yes, you have to explain to her that this is the best that she can get. Okay.
Okay.
I think in cases with a mild amblyopic eye, the non-dominant mild amblyopic eye, you can use it for monovision with very good results. If you think refractive.
You have to consider that this seven tenth. It will go to 3/10 in the farsightedness. If you do monovision in an amblyopic eye, this is a problem. Okay, she will not be pleased in the far vision.
So you have to decide if he is actually amblyopic or not.
Yes. Amblyopia is not a good start to proceed with monovision.
Exactly. Okay. And the next one, he's hyperop, okay? But his profession is truck driver, and he wants to get rid of the glasses, okay? This is the opposite. Can we provide him with 100% independence of glasses? Milto, can you promise this? Is a good idea?
100% not even by glasses. I cannot provide him because I think the problem here is that he is a drug driver. This is a major problem. And nothing else for me. I think...
What is the problem with drivers?
If he's a drug driver, he will certainly be annoyed by the ghost images and the halos that he will get at night driving. So if he... And there is no way, going back to what Solon says about monovision, you can imitate, you can see, simulate monovision with a contact lens. But the ghost images and the halos, there is no way to simulate them unless you give him some pictures. So in this case, I think it's a fantastic case scenario for if one thing is an end of lens, one thing, with a toricity, with a toric. I know that sometimes they don't, particularly the technics, they're not sitting the white, they may move. But anyway, you can try it. Or you can consider doing nothing.
You are already in the maximum level for hyperopic correction with refractive surgery. It's a plus five.
Okay.
If we say the best case scenario that this is his cycloplegic correction, the plus five, the maximum of his, I think you will induce harder aberrations with refractive surgery in this eye. And he would definitely be annoyed by night vision problems because he's a driver. I wouldn't go for refractive surgery. It's an extremity.
Okay, let's carry on. He's young, 27. Okay. High myope, moderate bathymetry, and he's diabetic. Any suggestions? Would you do anything here or not?
Only. I think it's clear. I don't have any second thoughts. ICL. Yeah, no other.
Why not a PRK?
Because he's diabetic.
Okay. So what?
Poor healing.
Okay.
They have healing problems with the epithelium.
You can end up with open epithelium forever. Okay. Every day you miss not to heal the epithelium, you're going to end up with severe haze.
So, okay, let's say, this is says ICL, why not artisan?
I'm coming to this. About the truck driver,
yes.
If you may.
He's still driving, yes.
He's still there.
So, the tattoo here, you know, the big truck driver.
Not so, laser would not be an option because, as Dimitri said, you will change the aberrometric profile of the cornea. He's going to be definitely, not maybe, definitely unhappy after laser procedure.
And not only at night, but only a day.
Yeah, day and night. And regarding EDOF, as Milto said, EDOF will perform better than trifocal, for example, but they also have photic phenomena. So
that's the definition of EDOF. EDOF induces chromatic aberrations in order to create this
it's
depth
a part
of focus.
Of the concept of the lens.
It's a part of the concept.
So I wouldn't use even an EDOF in this. I would do nothing in this patient personally.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Okay, very quickly. Okay, always when you see this optic nerve, just before you do something, take a picture, okay? Because the patient can come back with his lawyer and say, you did this to me, okay? Just save your ass, is the word. So the last, okay, no, maybe. This one.
Just until you find it. Just okay. Remember that myopia is connected with a lot of other problems in the eye. I came across two cases with retinitis pigmentosa, which came to us for a laser correction of their myopia. So always, when you're going to do a case, just examine the whole eye very carefully and listen to what the patient says. Because in one case, he had just one or two bone spicules, nothing really. And yet this guy ended up doing the laser and being unhappy about it because simply he had retinitis pigmentosa, but very, very subtle.
Okay, this poor patient has myopic PAK 3 years ago, and he ends up with this haze. So, Mr. Gadjuva said this before. What are you going to do here? What do you need to decide?
Decide if it's superficial or what?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
So what do you do
here? Just make the OCT. Okay, so you see here where the haze is. Okay, it's superficial, okay? So you can decide here to make a nice PTK and some PRK, okay, to solve the problem.
Actually, the only, some colleagues have issues with with PRK on superficial corneal scarring. If it's not a dense corneal scar, we should not actually have second thoughts because the alteration of the ablation depth caused because of the scarring is minimal and you will not have a big deviation from your target refraction. So I think in these patients where you say PTK or PRK because of this superficial haze, if you want to go for the PRK, you should just go for it.
Let's go for it with mitomycin, I suppose, okay? Thank you very much.